Good morning. Oh, that is such a wonderful welcome. Thank you so much. I didn't have to ask you to repeat yourselves. I am Pastor Bob, and I'd like to welcome you to Round Hill United Methodist Church, whether you're joining us online or whether you're here in person. We're so excited that you are with us today, that we're worshiping together, and that we're growing as a faith community. For visitors or those of you that might be new, I've just been here about 6 weeks or so. I can't even remember. It seems like it's gone so quickly, but just began in July, and so excited about what we're already doing together as a faith family. So I hope you'll find out more about who we are. Feel free to contact me. In our little bulletins, you'll see the web address that has my email and also my phone number. So love to connect with you, maybe have a coffee, and talk about how you can get connected to life and ministry here at Round Hill. Today, though, I'd like to invite those of you that are here to rise in spirit or in body as you're able, and let us share together in our call to worship. Disciples of Christ, why have you gathered today? God lives among us all the time. So why have you gathered today?
To remind one another that God lives among us and worship.
When you scatter from this place, what will you take with you?
Hearts open to recognize God living among us.
Then come, let us worship together. We come to worship with rejoicing the triune God who lives, loves, and moves among us as we gather and as we are sent from this place. Amen. Let us share in our opening hymn, Come, Now is the Time to Worship. Have a seat. Thank you for that wonderful call to worship, for gathering in song. We do rejoice that this is the day that the Lord has made. As we've gathered, though, we come bringing our celebrations and even our sorrows. So we are going to move into a time of prayer. If you are online, I'd love for you to maybe send in some prayer requests, celebrations, or prayer concerns you'd like to lift up. For those of you that are gathered here, I'll begin taking some of those celebrations. I know I celebrate all that is happening in ministry here. We really rejoice at all the backpacks that we shared with Round Hill Elementary and that we were able to send to support the teachers and the students. And we rejoice about the many things that God's doing in and through our life together here at Round Hill. What other celebrations might we have today? I saw you starting to sneak up there. It's okay.
My older nephew is a freshman at the Christopher Report, and we just moved them to his dorm yesterday.
Excellent. So new beginnings, yeah. Just sent him to Christopher Newport. That's your older nephew. Yep.
Our son Carson, we just took him down to JMU yesterday. So same thing.
More students being sent away to school and starting new seasons of learning and life. That's Carson. We lift Carson up. Yep. Other over here. Yep. Aaron. Tess and Riley, and you know what I love is that you guys, you know how important it is for your pastor to support our young adults, and you're going to send me to Denmark to do a pastoral visit, but, right? Yeah. In a crate. Yep. No, that's good. We do lift them up. Yes, Jim.
It's a joy for us to have our daughter Carrie with us today.
We do celebrate that your daughter is joining you in worship today. Great to be here, taking care of mom and dad. Doug. And what was your friend's name again?
Kaz.
Kaz. We lift up Kaz, who became a naturalized U.S. citizen this past week.
Yesterday.
That's exciting. Thanks for sharing that. That is a big celebration. Yes, Rhonda.
Celebration for 55 years living with this home.
That's right. Your anniversary, 55, the double nickel. Keep it steady. Just put it in there on cruise control now the rest of the way, right? Good job. You're putting up with him, you said? Or what? That's not what I heard. Oh, okay. Yeah, Scott.
Well, first of all, old men are really particularly special, so she's very fortunate. But the other thing, I had the opportunity to take yesterday and the day before to spend in the United Methodist class on spiritual gifts, and it was just a real blessing to be around people. I feel like I have a pretty deep faith, but to be surrounded by people with even deeper faith.
Excellent. Celebrating the opportunity to be part, and that was like a lay certification course through the United Methodist Church. That's part of the beauty of our connectional system is connecting with other United Methodists and realizing, wow, there's some really great stuff happening in our conference, in our district. So I'm glad that you were able to take that class. Yes, Lauren. Luke and Logan, way to mobilize and take care of mom and dad. That's great. Men of God, love it. Yes, Glenda, are these online?
I have a couple online praises. Jen Mulfair praised for our food pantry and the number of families that are supported by it, which occurred this weekend. And praises from Louise Spicer, praises that we have such a giving faith community as evidenced with our school supply outreach project.
Louise Spicer celebrating the work of our school supply projects as we sent those out, and Jen Moffer, the number of families that we touched with our food distribution this past week and through our food pantry.
I have another one too. Nancy Ehrenhalt said praises to all who give so much in effort to our church.
Nancy and Butch, we continue to celebrate all who do work and do ministry for our congregation. Thanks, Nancy, for lifting that up. And we're continuing in prayer for them. I thought I saw another hand starting to pop up, but maybe I'm just imagining things. It's a lot of celebrations. And we do want to lift up and remember that there are our congregants and our neighbors that we want to pray with and for as they're convalescing or healing, like Glenna, who's been transitioned to a rehabilitation center that she's done some time before, and she's real excited about being there. She feels very confident about the caregivers there, but we want to pray for her recovery. We know that, she likes to get out and about and doesn't like to be stuck in one place, so we want to continue to pray for Glenna after her fall last weekend. Other prayer concerns? Yes, Glenda.
I have some prayers online from Jen Mallfair. Prayers for my stepfather, Jerry, as he battles stomach cancer. Prayers for strength for my mom. Travel mercies for Jim and Ella this week, and prayers for all the teachers and students to come back to school on Thursday. I have a prayer, too.
Jen Mallfair, lifting up prayers for her stepfather, Jerry, for her mom, for the students and teachers going back to school this week. Was there one other there that I missed?
And then I got a prayer from Nancy Earnhaut, prayers for all that are ill.
Yeah, Nancy, lifting up those that are convalescing, praying for those that are going through different trials, medically, emotionally, spiritually, physically, and we pray for her and Butch as well, as they're at home watching from afar, and all those others that are not able to join us in person, we're praying with and for you as well today. And yes, Rita?
Jim's cousin, twice removed, Carolyn, she's non-believer and she doesn't know Jesus. We've been talking to her for several years now, but there is a lot of resistance and animosity towards this subject. So just a prayer about the situation, because we are trying.
It's his cousin's wife, and so praying that hearts would be softened and doors would be opened for spiritual conversation and for God to do a work of healing and reconciliation there. That's good. That's, Lauren?
Former
co-worker who lost her husband recently. We will pray for that family during their time of grief. And there was a hand. I did see a hand there. Yes. Dave
Gilbertson.
Okay, I wrote that down correctly. Dave Gilbertson, after a recent brain aneurysm, continuing to heal and convalesce, but praying for him and his family and supporting that small business here in town. Thank you for sharing that. Joe? Okay. Well, I know you're stewarding a lot of lives, and with the students that you're working with, so we'll pray for them. Yeah, Bob, maybe that's what I saw. I might have saw that. Bob, lifting up prayers for his family as they make decisions for family members for long-term care. And yeah, we know those are tough times of transition and preparation, so we will be with you in prayer for that. Thank you for sharing those. And do we have a list? Do we have the list of the students or young adults? Did we happen to get a slide? Was that this week that we were going to do that? Next week? Okay, that's cool. Sounds good. Just wanted to make sure that I wasn't missing. I know a lot of our college students, as we've shared today, have already gone off to school, and we didn't know if any were going to be around here. We also have a number of young adults that are going to vocational schools and serving in the military or serving in different social spaces and working new jobs. And as we think about them transitioning, we made a covenant with them during their baptism or during their time of confirmation that we'd support them, that we'd pray for them. So if you have anybody that you want to add to that list, you can send that in to the office, and we want to list them and pray specifically for them. Or Lucy, yep, send those to congregational care, and we'll get them up, and we'd like to recognize them. If any of them are here next week, we'd even invite them up that we can pray with and for them. And we'll also be praying over our students in school support staff next week. So a lot to pray for next week. It'll be a fun time. But let's go to God in prayer right now. Part of preparing for prayer, as you stay seated, we'll do a song of reflection. We're going to sing the hymn, Trust and Obey. So just kind of quietly meditate upon those words. And after we finish that beautiful hymn, then I'll lead us in a time of prayer and reflection, and we'll continue in worship. Let us pray.
Walk with the Lord in the light of His word, and the glory He shed on our way. While we do His good will, it abides with us still, and now oh, it doth and obey. Trust and obey, for it's the other way to be happy in Jesus, not to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a soul in our share, but a toil He doth richly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or the cross, but a bless He doth trust and obey. Trust and obey, there's no other way to be happy in Jesus, but a trust and obey. But we never can prove the delight of His love until all it out of the way. For the favor He shows, for the joy He bestows, and for them He the trust and obey. Trust and obey, for they know the way to be happy in Jesus, but they trust and obey. And a fellowship sweet, and a seat at His feet, or we'll walk by the side of the way. What He says we will do, and He says we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but a trust and obey.
May we bow our heads and lift our hearts in prayer. Come, Holy Spirit, kindle a fire in our hearts this day. May you spark the embers of love, that they may glow in such a way as to let the world see the light of Christ in each of us. We do trust, we do obey and follow your challenge to pray for one another. We've lifted up celebrations today. We celebrated anniversaries and returns to school. Children moving into new stages of life, we know that you are with them as we have sent them out. We know that you are with us as we gather here. We thank you for the joy of what it means to be a church, to be a gathered body of believers in Jesus, connected by the love of Christ, and that we are the hands and feet of Christ, serving our community by supporting our schools, those that are dealing with food insecurity. You are a good, good Father. We ask that we would be faithful children, living out your call to love one another. As we pray for those things that we celebrate and rejoice in, we also know that there are many who are recovering from illness, from injury. We know that there are families that are grieving from the loss of husbands and fathers, and families that are making difficult decisions about transitional care and end-of-life care. You desire the best quality of life for each and every one of us. And we need to understand that that happens when we open ourselves up to the work of your Spirit in our lives. That we cannot do it alone, but we do it through the empowering of you, Christ our Lord in us, the hope of glory. We come together in community because we know that this journey is not meant to be handled alone. We pray with and for one another. We surround each other with our embraces, with our love, with our support. Whether it's a card or of encouragement, whether it's a meal to support us in the time where you just don't have the energy to make dinner. There are small ways that these acts of love change lives. We pray that you would be the God of transformation, not only in our hearts, but in the heart of this community. We pray for Round Hill. We pray for Loudoun County. We pray for the extended Commonwealth of Virginia, that you would help guide leaders within our community, whether they're political leaders or doctors, physicians, teachers, educators, engineers, housewives and husbands, workers on the front line. May we be ambassadors of your love. We pray for our nation. We pray for our world, for you are the Prince of Peace, and it is your shalom that we desire. We pray all these things in the strong name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Our scripture today comes from Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus, chapter 6, verses 10 through 20. This is from the New Revised Standard Version, and you might be familiar with it as being the whole armor of God. So we will open up what this means for us as we are sent out to go and be the people of God in the world. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against blood and flesh, but it's against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present age, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God so that you may be able to withstand on the evil day, and having prevailed against everything, to stand firm. Stand, therefore, and belt your waist with truth, and put on the breastplate of righteousness, and lace up your sandals in preparation for the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer and supplication, and to that end, keep alert and always persevere in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly as I must speak. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. I'd like to invite the children to come up if they're still around. We're going to do a little message. We won't go on a big tour like we did last week, but you guys can help me out here. Because are you all reader leaders? Do you guys like to read? And are you all like spelling superpower? We're going to do a little spelling. This is a very small quiz, and this is easy. Okay. The Jesus has a father in heaven. Who's that?
God.
Good job. Okay, what are the first two letters of God?
G-O.
Good. You're already there. Okay. The Bible, we call that the good news, right? The good news. What are the first two letters of good news?
G-O.
Oh, you're trying to do Bible. I got you. Good news. G-O. Good job. And what about gospel? What is that?
G-O.
Oh my goodness, we seem to have a pattern here, don't we?
Yeah.
What?
It's all G-O's.
It's all G-O's, yeah. Go, go, go. What do you think God might be trying to remind us to do?
Go.
Go, that's right. God doesn't call us to be a sit-still kind of people. God calls us to be a go kind of people. That's right. Can you show me how you go? Can you go real fast for me? Ah, yeah. God tells us that we're not just called to gather, but he also tells us to go, therefore, to all the world. We're going to talk about that a little bit later in our message. But I want you guys to remember, even though for this next couple of minutes, your parents might want you to sit still and to not make too much rowdiness. But afterwards, I want you guys to go, and I want you to share the love of God. I want you to be the light of Christ to all those around you. Can you guys do that for me? Sure. Yeah. Okay. I love it. High fives. Psh, 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 psh. Great. Let's pray. Dear God, help us remember to go.
Let us be
your light and love.
In your name, amen.
Excellent. Thank you guys so much. I'll see you soon. Very cool. Good helpers. Way to go. Go, go, go. Okay. The word today from Ephesians. You might be saying, oh my goodness, Pastor Bob, what are you doing? Talking about crazy stuff. Talking about putting on armor. And we've got so much political unrest. We've got so much war and grief going on around the world. That sounds like a pretty salty scripture there. But I want to challenge us to think about what lenses Paul might be having us look at the scripture today as we think about the final part of our sermon series about worship with rejoicing, as we think about how we've moved through the order of worship and we come to this place of benediction, of good words to prepare us to be sent out, to go from this place. We are people that gather, but then we gather so that we might be scattered, so that we might go. And that's God's call upon us. It's hard to remember that because we feel so good when we gather here and we sing those songs and hymns, right? Feels good. But we have to go out into the world. And that's who Jesus calls us to be, disciples. I'm going to talk more about discipleship and the calling of disciples next week, so make sure you come back next week too, okay? Let's pray. Dear Lord, I ask that you would let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you. You are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Amen. The armor of God. Paul is writing this letter to the church of Ephesus. Does anybody know where they think that he was writing this letter from? There's a hint in the last verse. Jail. Prison. Yeah, he says, I'm in bondage. I'm in chains, and I'm writing this letter to you. And so when you're behind bars, you don't have a lot of opportunity to actually do anything offensive or attack anybody or be on the to be on the front lines. You're behind bars. But he's surrounded by all these guards, these Roman centurions and these guards. So he's probably spending the whole day looking at the armor that they're wearing and considering, you know, what does that mean? What's the armor that we as followers of Jesus should wear? And we can very quickly look at the language here and think about, well, Paul's always talking about empire and the way that Rome is oppressing the people and there's so much behind that. So what's he really doing to challenge us as people that are not working against overthrowing the empire, but people that are understanding Jesus is ushering in of a new kingdom, of a spiritual kingdom. What do we do to be prepared for that new kingdom? How do we arm ourselves? How do we protect ourselves in this kingdom? And we think of armor, a lot of times we think of what a soldier would wear to prepare him to go out into battle. But Paul subverts that. And he subverts that by speaking about armor in its defensive way. There's only one piece of armor that he says that could actually be used for attack, and that's the very last piece. We'll get to that. But the first thing he says is that I'm praying that you would withstand those things that are around you, the pressure of society, that you would stand firm. So he wants us to have a confidence that we're not alone, that God is with us. And he says that as you stand firm, I want you to begin by girding yourself with a belt of truth. That's your first line of defense. And he doesn't say that truth is an ideology or an opinion. He doesn't say that what truth is, other than that truth is Christ. That there is a person who is truth, that the one that we ground our truth in, that the one we found our identity in is the image of God in which we're made. That we belt ourselves with the image of Christ, that we belt ourselves with truth. And we start with the very time of preparation by knowing that we are God's and that we are created in God's image. So what does it mean to be that imitation of Christ? We talked about that a few weeks ago. It says after you put that belt of truth on, that then you need to protect your heart. Because even though we might know what the truth is, we can let the lies of the world, we can let the noise of the messages around us put in seeds of doubt and seeds of uncertainty. And so he says, put on that breastplate of righteousness. Know that it's not in your righteousness that you survive, but it's in the righteousness of Christ that God sees you. So protect your heart. Know that in that space of vulnerability, that space of opening yourselves up to surrender to God, that's where you'll find your greatest strength. So put that breastplate of righteousness on so that you can protect your heart. And then he talks about sandals. You know, sandals don't seem, I would never wear a sandal when I'm riding my motorcycle. That's not very good protective foot gear, is it? No, you got to wear boots so that you don't get your ankles torn up. But he says, okay, and then you lace up your sandals in preparation for the gospel of peace. And he's giving us this peculiar picture here. What do you mean, sandals for the gospel of peace? And maybe he's challenging those that are listening to remember that beautiful poetry. You know, how beautiful are the feet of the one on the mountaintop who brings good news, the gospel of peace. And we wear those sandals that we can run and sprint to that finish that Christ calls us towards. And then finally, we have this shield of faith that he says, which will quench the flaming arrows of those that are around us. And if you know anything about the Roman legions and the centurions that were marching forward, their shield was actually covered with leather, and they would soak it in water so that when the attacking enemies would shoot the flaming arrows, when it would hit their shields, it would douse the flame. He says, in that same way, get your line of defense in such a way that they can't break your defense, that even any argument or lie that they would cast against you, any condemnation, would be quenched by the water of the Spirit, by God's truth. That helmet of salvation that you put on to protect your most important part, your cranium. You know, we know that we wear a helmet because that's where the most lethal blow can come. As if the lies get into our mind. If the seeds of dissent, the seeds of confusion, of condemnation, take root and cause us to fester in bitterness and anger and uncertainty. So we wear that helmet of salvation, knowing that salvation is new every morning, that God says, don't get stuck in the old ways. Don't listen to the lies of the past. Turn down the record player that's telling you that lie of shame and guilt. And remember that you are a new creation in Christ. That salvation is that making whole of your body, mind, soul, and spirit. Remember that your salvation is in and through Christ. And here's the one weapon that I give you. It's the sword of the Spirit. But what's the sword of the Spirit? It's the Word of God. So we've got a loop here. The Word of God is the gospel of peace. So how can you use peace as a weapon? How can we put on this armor of protection and then know that the thing that we go into battle with is the peaceable kingdom that God calls us to? This is the upside down story of the gospel, where the meek shall inherit the earth, where we must love not only our neighbor, but pray for our enemy, where we kill our opponents with kindness by heaping coals upon their head with our words of love and grace, with the compassion that we show them, with the mercy that we give them. That's the reversal of the gospel, because the world tells us eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, that you need to climb a little bit higher than the person that puts you down so you can make them hurt a little bit more, and that you need to get back and get even. Jesus says, I tell you, there's another way. If someone asks for your cloak, then give them your shirt also. If someone strikes you on one side of your face, then turn your cheek. This is the difficulty of answering God's call to go. We do it as we prepare ourselves in prayer. Last week we were challenged and we said that prayer is the foundation, the first and foremost spiritual discipline which will help us understand the mind of Christ. So again, Paul returns to this challenge. Pray in the Spirit at all times in every prayer and supplication. Let's read that one together. If you can put, oh, you got that up there. Let's back up one more there, Glenda. Let's read this first part here. Pray in the Spirit at all times in every prayer and supplication. At all times. We can't let our defenses down. We have to know that mindfulness and gratitude and times of meditation will help center us on the person of Christ. That we need to walk in an attitude of prayer, that every step we take is another step of expanding God's presence here on earth. Because we are the ambassadors of God's love. Jesus looked at those around him and he said, the kingdom of God is in you. The kingdom of God is in you. The kingdom of God is in you. It's right here. It's not just something that's coming, but it's already breaking in to our reality. Because where you are setting foot into this world on my behalf. You're my ambassador. Just like we send an ambassador over to another country and they're an emissary for the United States, we are the ambassadors of God's kingdom. In every community that we move into, in every office space that we walk into, in every classroom that we inhabit, in every filling station that we stop by to pump our gas, God tells us to go. Paul says, I'm an ambassador in chains. I'm stuck here in this prison. You all are here today because none of you are stuck in prison. He's sharing this message in captivity, but we have this privilege of freedom. We have this privilege and opportunity to be in spaces where others cannot be. We are in a country where we have the freedom of speech, where we can share, speak the truth in love, we were told a few weeks ago. But we have privilege and we should use it. We are privileged citizens of God's kingdom, and we have a way to inhabit the very attitude of love that God calls us to. And that's good news. That's good news. Now, the benediction that we talked about, those are good words. Each time when we finish our message together, when we come into that place where we get ready to head out, there's a benediction, which means good words. And Paul says that we need to remember that like that benediction, Paul tells us, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Paul doesn't say, be strong in your own strength. He says, it's not your strength that's going to give you the opportunity to walk into the world, but it's the strength of the Lord. It's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by my Spirit, says the Lord. So when we are here gathering and worshiping and praying together, we have that benediction that says, I'm equipping you. You are going forth, not in your own strength, but now recharged with the Holy Spirit. You're going forth in the strength and in the power of the Lord. And then we send out. You're empowered and equipped by the opportunity to worship together, to study God's word, but then you're sent. As we shared at Matthew 28 scripture, go, therefore. Let me hear you all say that. Go, therefore. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. That was a little weak. I'm going to have you guys do that again. Maybe you weren't ready. We're going to do that. Go, therefore, okay? Go, therefore. Remember that. And make disciples of all nations, of all people. Pantata ethne is what it says in the scripture, which means people of every race, of every nation, of every God, that you would go to them, that you would love them, that you would care for them, that you would baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, and that you would teach them to obey. Trust and obey everything that I've commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the very end of the age. We don't go alone. We don't go in our own power. But we go knowing that the Holy Spirit has prepared a way before us. And that's good news, I think. That's the gospel. That God is with us. That God is for us. That God is in relationship. And he is not far off, but he is present. He is dwelling in us. As we abide in Christ, Christ abides in us. And we go, making a difference. We are transformed that we might be transforming our communities, our children, our families, the lives of those around us, that we are agents of love. My kids are reading a book series, City Spies, you know, and I always used to want to be like 007, you know. I used to watch James Bond. I loved it. Somehow they were always on in the winter, and you would pray that the school was going to be closed the next day so you could stay up and watch the last few minutes of the James Bond movie, because I wanted to be an agent. And I've got that opportunity now. I can be like a secret agent, an undercover espionage ambassador of love. And I want to invite you guys into that mission, right? If you go into my office, you'll see a poster there that a good friend had given me. It's Jake and Elwood Blues. That's one of the places that I got some of my theology before I was a Christian, was the Blues Brothers. How many of you have seen the movie, The Blues Brothers? There you go. Yeah. Why do they do what they do? Because they're on a mission from God. Yeah. Who ever thought that John Belushi was going to be an evangelist to a little kid from Indianapolis? I mean, that's big stuff. God works in mysterious ways. Paul tells us right there that we would know the mystery of the gospel as we gather together. That's my hope and prayer for you. We're finishing up this series on worship. It's right there in your hymnals. If you pick out your hymnals, it shows you the order of worship and what they encourage us to do. And there are reasons why we move through that rhythm each week of gathering, of calling to worship, of lifting up songs from the camp. It looks like the temple. It looks like the tabernacle. When people would come to worship at the tabernacle, they would come into the gates and they would be singing in songs like those returning to camp and singing the songs of joy. And as you go in, you come to a place where you cleanse yourself and you have prayer and you ask for forgiveness, and then you go towards the Holy of Holies after you've given your offering and you encounter the living God. And that's what we're about to do right now, is we're about to pull back the curtain, know that God meets us right here in this meal, that the real presence of Christ is with us as we share in communion. And as we get that nourishment from the table, as we have that spiritual recharge, the body and blood of Christ that renews us and restores us, and we're sent out from this place. We're on a mission from God. Can you guys say that with me? We're on a mission from God. It's good news. It's the gospel. It's the journey that we're invited into. And I invite each of you to begin that journey today as we come and share at the Lord's table. Christ our Lord invites all to his table who love him, who earnestly seek to repent of their sin and live in peace with one another, the gospel of peace. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us search our hearts in a time of repentance, in a time of discovery. May God's Holy Spirit show you those things that you need to confess, that maybe it's a relationship that's broken with a neighbor, a friend, a loved one. Maybe it's an attitude that you're carrying around that you shouldn't have, anger, resentment. Maybe it's a brokenness in a relationship with God. But let us go to God in a time of confession and repentance. Holy God, for the things that we've done that we shouldn't have done, or for those things that we should have done that we didn't do, we ask your forgiveness. Heal us, give us hope, restore us. Let us know that we are new creations in Christ. These things we pray in your name. Amen. My friends, hear the good news of the gospel. Christ died for us. While we were yet sinners, that proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the
name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Let us stand as you're able and take a moment to offer signs of peace to one another. Share the peace of Christ be with you and also with you, whether it's an elbow bump or a hug. You all figure that out. Offerings of worship. We share our gifts of tithes and the resources that you've allowed us to earn through our calling in the world. We ask that you would use these gifts, that you would multiply them for your ministry, not only here at this local church, but throughout our community and to the very ends of the earth. These things we pray in the name of Christ. Amen. Amen. Let's continue with the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and with all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery of sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and by the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to you, O Lord. He broke bread and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, He gave thanks to you, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Let us pray. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the very body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Now, with the confidence of children of God, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, this is the body of Christ given for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. The table has been set. This is gluten-free bread, if anyone has a concern for that. There are also small elements that you can take individually if you would not like to receive. We'll be having communion through intinction. I'll break off a piece of the bread, and you'll dip it into the juice, and we release from this side, and then everyone kind of moves around and follows the flow. You'll see how they start, and I believe we'll be able to follow that. But I'd like to invite the worship team to come forward first, and I invite you all, come to the table. And if you'd like, there's a little bit of room on the prayer rail here. If you'd like to spend a moment in prayer, feel free to utilize that after you've received the elements.
Change a heart of God, make every true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and
mold me and make me
Let us pray. Holy God, we have gathered at your table. We have communed with you and with the great cloud of witnesses, for you promise that the real presence of Christ is here. And each time that we share in this meal, all those that have been in Christ before us and that will be in Christ after us, break through time and space and feast at your great banquet. We pray that you would equip us with your Holy Spirit as we go forth from this place, nourished by this meal of thanksgiving. These things we pray in your name. Amen. Amen. I invite you to rise in body and spirit as you're able, and let's share in our final hymn, He Leadeth Me. G-O kind of people. What kind of people are we?
Yeah.
go. As we go, we don't go in our own strength. We go because God leads us. And where he leads me, I will follow. Amen?
Amen.
Go knowing that the Holy Spirit has prepared a way before you, that Christ is in you, the hope of glory, that God is with you. And if God is with us, who can be against us? Amen?
Amen.
Go in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord's face continue to shine upon you all the days of your life. Amen.